This is a story of brotherhood, redemption, and one hell of a time for 50 platoon soldiers in the summer of 1979. Boys grew to men, and men to leaders. In 1979, Americans were reeling from the long Vietnam War that ended in 73, and U.S. military enlistment was at an all-time low. Due to this, criminals had two options: go to jail or enlist in the military in an attempt to fill up the ranks. However, this was creating a weaker military by accepting substandard soldiers. The Army needed to attract better and more educated soldiers to run the advanced weapons being developed. To do so, they were forced to offer enlistment bonuses, such as paying for college tuition. This attracted the role of Jim Murphy, who became the recruiter for the National Guard in a small town in Lexington, Nebraska, and had the local nickname Big Jim.
Big Jim.
Big Jim.
Big Jim had the nickname Big Jim because he was a big square guy, just like a Nebraska lineman. He was the captain of the team as a lineman, which is hard to do. He was also an Army Ranger. So an Army Ranger is like a Navy SEAL for the Army, and they're the elite of the elite in the Army. You know, he was a guy that was a great dad, he was very supportive. But he was also a guy that had a command voice. When he said you did something, you just did it.
So he had to go to the regular Army, which didn't always think that highly of the National Guard, and talk them into allowing us to complete our basic and AIT all at the same time. One station unit training is what it was called. In fact, I think they named it after Big Jim did this.
This would allow the regular Army to see how the Nebraska unit with college incentive stacked up with the five other regular Army platoons. So they decided to accept Big Jim's idea. They made it clear to Big Jim that if any of the Nebraska platoon did not pass the tests, they would be recycled and would miss college. No exceptions.
You boys are going to have to figure out a way to pay for part of your college. And you can either join the Army or you can join the National Guard.
It was almost like an Amway salesman, every two that you got to sign up, you got an extra stripe. And so Big Jim got Little Jim and Dan and Joe, and then they just recruited the rest of us. So
you didn't say no to Big Jim. So when he got a hold of us and started talking to you, it was pretty much a done deal, really. I mean, he was a hell of a salesman.
Yes, he was.
And Jim Murphy had the vision to, put together this whole Nebraska platoon. I think he was the author of it.
I didn't really know what I wanted to do the rest of my life, and wanted to get out of Cozad, and that was a fast way to do it.
The chance to go to Fort Knox, Kentucky with guys who I grew up with was once in a lifetime event for me.
I got a call from my dad. I was finishing my first year of law school, and he said, Jim Murphy's gonna call you, and he's got a good idea, you probably ought to say yes, but it's up to you. But it pays for a lot of your tuition, but it's up to you. And he might have said that three more times. It sounded like a good idea, because it sounded like something other than law school. So I was a pretty easy sell, too.
Joe, if I was you, I probably would have regretted that.
I didn't. No, I was.
Big Jim always believed that if your country were to help you with college, you must first do something to help it.
And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
Big Jim had done the impossible of filling up an entire state quota as one recruiter. The goal was 8 boys, and he signed up 50. It was time to head to Fort Knox, Kentucky, and see how the Big Red Platoon matched up.
We all climbed on that C-130 plane, and it was in Kearney, Nebraska. And we got off 2.5 hours later in Fort Knox, Kentucky. A short flight, and through the reception, we had our haircuts. A lot of us had hair at that time.
The shots were one of the first things that we had to do. So.
Yeah, the shots were one of the worst. And then we get the shots, get our hair buzzed off, get our uniforms, and we have to go on a 5 or 7 mile hike,
yeah,
in brand new boots.
Yeah.
And everybody is just sick and full of blisters. And
the young men would also be introduced to their drill sergeants, Sergeant Kirk and Sergeant Gwill.
I would say that Sergeant Kirk was more of a mentor, kind of teacher, coach. That's what the senior drill sergeant is supposed to be. And Drill Sergeant Will was supposed to be the tougher, tough love kind of drill sergeant.
Out of all the instructors we could ever get in Fort Knox, I mean, we really, really liked that. We got two outstanding guys.
PT was the majority of all early testing, from 2 mile runs to monkey bars and obstacle courses. Everything deemed a grade, all while the drill sergeants mentally tried to break down every soldier, pushing them to their limits.
You will not laugh. You will not cry. You will learn by the numbers. I will teach you.
Most of the other platoons had recruits dropping like flies, but the Nebraska boys were all excelling. After the first 2 weeks, the first platoon had earned the drill sergeant's respect and won 10 out of 10 on the PT scoring. Training continued, and so did the Nebraska boys' domination in achieving number one spots compared to the rest of the platoon.
I think one of the reasons the Nebraska platoon was so successful was that we learned early on, one of the ways that the military trains you is one fail, you all fail.
We knew what our purpose was, and that was to be the best that we could be while we were there. We wanted to make Big Jim proud of us, our families to be proud of what we've done. And so we were shooting for the honor platoon from the day we got there. With that made us, we kind of had a target on our back.
A young fellow in the other platoon on a camp out got angry and put a M16 at my head. We didn't think it was loaded, but you don't want to get too risky there.
The other platoons were ready to beat the Nebraska boys on something they felt they had a level playing field, weapons training.
You know, they didn't know that the Nebraska guys, we all grew up hunting, right? We were shooting shotguns at ducks and pheasant and geese since we were 10 years old, right? So we knew how to break down weapons. We knew how to clean weapons. We knew how to sight weapons. So when it came to weapons training, you know, they got waxed even worse than they did in the other tests.
By the time the weapons training was over, the Nebraska platoon had won all 11 weapons contests. The platoon had finished the basic training part of the summer, and the Nebraska boys were still undefeated. The other platoons had to change their goal from winning honor platoon to winning something far more physical.
There was one night where a group of guys were coming back from the enlisted club, and a large group of soldiers from other platoons jumped them and cheap shotted them. And when they got back and told us about it, we decided that we were going to show that we were of quality, I guess I would say. So we went to the enlisted club that night, and I think it was Dan Murphy let a couple of them know that we were not happy about the incident that happened prior to, and that we were willing to follow up on it if they wanted to. Well, when we got outside, it was pretty evident that the numbers were not equal, but at that point, we didn't really care. We were there to prove that we were Huskers.
So once we got outside, we were outnumbered. We had all our red shirts on, and what happens in a lot of, you know, fights is when the first couple of guys go down, sometimes a lot of other guys didn't want to get in. So that's what happened. Nebraska boys won the fight, but we lost the battle because here came the MPs. And pretty soon, a bunch of the Nebraska boys were handcuffed and on the way to the brig, me included. And even though that was an unfortunate incident, it did put the other platoons on notice. You mess with one guy in red, you're going to get 50 guys coming your direction.
And then Will telling us that, yeah, he might not graduate. Really?
Right. Well, then he also said, next time you guys go in with your t-shirts, let me know. I'll bring mine in and we'll all go together.
Yeah.
No. That's great.
The other platoon started to respect the Nebraska men. Friendships were formed and the fighting came to an end. The other platoon soon came around to the fact that they were all part of a company of platoons, and having the Nebraska platoon made the company stronger. There was one part of the test that remained, and that was advanced military training, which included tanks, how to drive them, how to shoot them, and how to stay safe and work as a team in them.
When the Nebraska platoon went to the tank training part, they learned the crew duties of a 52-ton tank. In the crew of a 52-ton tank, there are four crew members, There's a driver, loader, gunner, and tank commander. The tank commander is in charge of the tank.
Move to the right, follow the trail.
When the tank commander gives the fire command, he announces what kind of round to put down range. In doing so, the gunner will index the proper round in the computer, which enhances the ballistic reticle for that round to be used. We'll load the proper round out of the honeycomb into the gun tube and announce up, meaning he's clear of the recoil path.
Rocket into a cradle just like this. Lay it on the stub base. Line it up. Just make a fist. Like this. You don't worry with the gun firing. Things on safe, ain't nothing gonna happen to you. Alright, make a fist. Drive that dome. Now, get out of the path of recoil. Alright, cross your arms, whatever you do, get out of the way, look at the ammo door. Alright, stay back, hunker in the corner. So I guarantee you when that bad boy fires for the first time, if you're in the way, you wish you were out of the way.
The Nebraska platoon won all 10 tank table tests and remained undefeated. Then there was knowledge of battle tactics and identifying enemy planes, tanks, and ships. Since most of the Nebraska men were in college or heading to college, the competitive beatdown was even worse in this section, and they won the last 7 tests. The Nebraska platoon had done the impossible, winning 38 out of 38 tests throughout the summer.
That is pretty phenomenal. I mean, we outperformed. This Nebraska platoon outperformed every single category or vertical in the U.S. Army at Fort Knox, Kentucky in 1979. We outshot everybody. Athletes, good athletes, collegiate athletes, state championship athletes, smart guys. It really had successful careers, and I think that's what it's all about, protecting your country, protecting your family.
And just like that, they were awarded honor platoon and graduation. Big Jim had the responsibility of giving the men their certificates, since he put the whole platoon together and showed the military how his plan of college incentives can grow the military. Big Jim's father-in-law, Monty Kiffin, World War II veteran, also had the chance to see the ceremony. 50 young men left for basic training in May, and 50 hardened soldiers came home 90 days later. Many of this platoon got back together in Lexington, Nebraska, to reflect on the whole experience. Here are a few of their thoughts on what this experience did for them and why the Nebraska platoon excelled.
Well, it makes you grow up, I guess. Just kind of rounded me into a whole person, and I went on, like I said, and made a career out of it for 26 years and ended up overseas, so.
There wasn't a whole hell of a lot when I got back from basic training that I didn't feel I couldn't do.
Well, it made me realize how good Nebraska was, seeing other parts of the United States and so forth, and I had met tremendous amount of friends. I got to know the Murphys and Big Jim, and I'm very blessed for that.
I've said this many times, it's the most pivotal experience of my life, because this basic that we did together tested me mentally, physically, like nothing else ever did in my life. So everything else, every other challenge that came after that was relatively easy. Med school, residency, all that stuff. A lot of people had trouble with that. And I'm not saying it wasn't easy, that it was easy, it was not. But having gone through this experience, it was like, hey, I can do this.
I think this just made us better though. It allowed some guys to have that self-confidence to go one step further, right? It allowed, you know, guys go to law school, guys go to medical school. It allowed them to do that because they could get their tuition paid, but also gave them the self-confidence. Yeah, I can do that. So I think the guys would have been in good shape anyway, but I think this helped them go from maybe pretty good to great.
My dad, Big Jim, and we've mentioned before, he believed in his product, and his product was the military. Army, Navy, Air Force, Marine, anything you go into, it was going to allow a young man or a young woman to gain some confidence, to learn how to do some things, to meet some people, to learn what teamwork is like. That experience is going to help any young person. Well, I'll just tell Big Jim, thanks. Thanks for a great summer and a great life.
Joe Kelly went on to get his law degree and become the United States Attorney for Nebraska. Scott Hofferper runs a major hospital for Banner Health, and Mark Catterson, a doctor. The rest became teachers, principals, electricians, firemen, and strong members of their community. While David Zlakowski, Leon Haith, and Jim Murphy stayed in for over 20 years and went on to serve in Iraq.
I have a great visit here at the museum in Lexington, Nebraska, my hometown, not far from one day I'll be buried, but thank you.
Even some of the other drill sergeants wanted us to fail. And about every now and then they would do surprise searches with German Shepherds. And these German Shepherds would just go wall locker, look and see if somebody got drunk. And this guy from the 3rd Platoon was in charge of it. And by the time he got to the 3rd floor, right, everybody thought it was going to be clean. And then he goes over to Steve Locker's area. The dog just starts barking. He goes, I told you these guys, they can't be this clean. It's not possible, right? It's right there in that radiator. And he pulls the radiator off, and Steve Blocker had hid some Oreo cookies in the radiator. He loved Oreo cookies, and they were illegal to have. The guy literally just goes, oh, my God, these guys have Oreo cookies instead of drugs.
There were two hills called Misery and Agony, but they're called that because you had to walk up and run up them during the day, and there were steep hills and the problem. But we had gone out for an overnight bivouac, is what they call it in the old days. But then we were doing the move during the night, so we're marching with our weapons, and we're going down the hill. And Dan, who's definitely afraid of snakes, said, and he was at the beginning. Now, I'm going to go
because back.
Because of the squad leader, because he had recruited some people. I'm not sure because he was a good squad leader, because he had recruited some other people.
That's semantics.
But anyway, he comes up, he sees a snake, he jumps over the snake and yells, oh, snake! But when he does that, somehow he trips and falls.
I wasn't taking part in the marching, so Drill Sergeant Quill wanted me to do his laundry for him, so he asked me if I knew how to do laundry. So I said, sure, I had no clue. I knew it was not laundry. I said, whatever. So he gives me his laundry. I go down, throw all his laundry in the washing machine, and didn't separate anything. And it gets done, and I pull it out, and he had his softball uniform in there. It was white with pinstripes, and it washed it with his red, t-shirt, shorts, whatever, and it came out, and it was bright pink.
I didn't remember that till now.
Yeah, and he shows up, and he's like, he's looking at it, and he's like, what did you do? So we tried to bleach it, couldn't get it bleached, and he had a game that night, so we threw it in the dryer to try and get it dried in time, and we couldn't get it dry, so he ends up having to go play softball. Not only is his white uniform pink, it's still soaking wet from not getting it dried, so that's my best moment. Perfect.
I recall a story about being on KP duty. I had a relatively easy job swatting flies initially. Of course, I got caught talking with somebody, so I got busted from that to pots and pan detail with Sid Gurman. It was a terrible job. It was hot. There was a ton of pots and pans. Didn't think we'd ever get through with them. But of course, Sid, he's got to start screwing around some way. He's got to find some activity in this that's amusing. So he takes off my hat, throws it in the water. I take off his hat, throw it in the water. And we gradually up the ante. He starts throwing saucepans full of water at me. I throw saucepans full of water at him. He eventually fills up a 10-gallon pot of water. And I see him coming at me with the thing out of the corner of my eyes and get out of the way just in time. He gets me completely wet from the waist down. Just floods the floor of the kitchen. The mess sergeant comes back there and he's incensed. What's going on back here? I said, Sarge, I think that drain over there's backed up. And he bought it.
Okay, great. You guys are done.
Yay!